Richard and Caitlin Rosenberg, I can't tell you what a thrill it is to see you in person and to be asked to interview you about the National Music Festival. Thank you very much for the invitation. How have you been?
Oh, goodness. Well, first of all, thank you so much for accepting the invitation, because we are delighted to be interviewed by you.
And it's great to see you. Actually, it's great to see anybody, but it's really great to see you.
We have not gotten older. We have all gotten younger. Last year did not count. We are here because I feel like you're part of my family. Celebrating the 10th anniversary of the National Music Festival, could you have imagined, Richard and Caitlin, that we would be doing this when you inaugurated it 10 years ago? Could you see it in your head?
I thought we would. I thought we had something really great to offer, and it's met every one of my hopes and dreams for the festival. I think we've trained a lot of great young musicians. We continue to do so shortly, and I think we've presented lots of great concerts, and we have our first commercial CD in the pipeline. So I think it's evolved as I wanted it to, as I hoped it would, and as so many people worked to achieve.
Hopes and dreams. Dreams, isn't it great when dreams come true? It's in Chestertown, Maryland, maybe for folks who aren't aware. And Caitlin, that is your home. And one of the things that has impressed me over the last 10 years is how much the town itself, not just the people, not just the beautiful scenery, not just the architecture, but the town has embraced the festival to the point where I just feel you don't have to say anymore. You don't have to explain who you are anymore. It's like the two are almost synonymous. And that, I would suggest, is a lot of your doing. Richard, no, I mean, I'm not shading the talent and everything that's going on, but Caitlin, it's you have helped establish those roots. You planted those seeds and those roots have grown, and the garden is extraordinary. Could you have imagined that it would have taken on the significance in your home?
Yes and no. For me, when we first started, I, of course, dreamed that it would be thriving 10 years later, but being the administrative half of this duo, I think so much of my focus in those early years was on the how of, you know, how were we going to launch this organization? How were we going to get everything done? And of course, in the beginning, I was doing a lot more of those tasks myself. And now we have a thriving, not just board of directors, but group of volunteers and committees and the wonderful local family who host musicians in their homes and of the people. I mean, as you said, the town has really, and the whole community here has just embraced the festival in a way that I hoped for, but has exceeded, I think, even my wildest dreams.
Well, let's see what, I can't use the word see on the radio. You can tell I haven't done it for a while. Let's hear some of what makes the festival so exciting. And I feel like I'm playing Desert Island Discs. but Richard, you have given me a list of musical selections. And I mean, people are so thirsty for music right now that I think, why not? Let's do it. It's 5 minutes and 50 seconds of some beautiful music. You've chosen Cole Porter's Overture to Aladdin, and this is from a performance on June 16th, 2012, so a very early performance. Explain, first of all, what it is this piece says to you enough so that it becomes the one that you want to start this 10th anniversary celebration with.
Cole Porter's final musical was written for CBS for the DuPont Show of the Month. It was broadcast in February of 1958. It had a cast including Cyril Richard, Sal Mineo, Anna Maria Alberghetti, Una Merkel, and Basil Rathbone singing. He was the emperor. Yeah. And my parents let me stay up well past my bedtime, which started, I think, at 8 p.m. On this DuPont Show of the Month, Better Living Through Chemistry. And it was one of the first compositions that I really gravitated towards. And the music was then lost. Cole Porter was not happy with it because in order to fit into the amount of time that they had on CBS with the DuPont advertisements, they cut it to smithereens. So I spent many, many years looking for the materials for this and was sitting at a performance of music by Jerome Maross at Bard College. And the person sitting next to me said, last week I was at the Lincoln Central Library and saw a slew of boxes that were marked AL. And so I went immediately the following day, and this was, well, it was in 2005, I think it was. Anyway, it was a long time ago. I discovered these boxes in which music were just thrown into it haphazardly of all these materials. The manuscript for the libretto, which was by S.J. Perlman, was at Yale, so I had that. But these materials had been lost for, I don't know, over 50 years.
Wow.
And so I spent a couple of years reassembling it. And I remember Don Vappi came and played guitar in the performance. And he said, it looks like a ransom note, because I had to put everything together. Anyway, when I was conducting this, and I did the first complete performance of the musical ever, but it was such an emotional experience that I was actually weeping during the overture and towards the end.
All right.
But well, you can probably hear it.
Well, yeah, you've just given us the beautiful prelude to it.
Okay.
Great.
So
I will
let's
go ahead
locate it
and start that up.
Okay, it'll take a second. Uh-huh. Video. And this is the overture. Volume's up. Volume's up. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
That's Cole Porter's Overture to Aladdin that was performed in June 16th, 2012 by the National Music Festival Orchestra under the baton of Richard Rosenberg. I think looking at some of those pictures, we probably should again remind people that this production was from 1958. Aladdin, I mean, when you see, you know, the makeup and so forth, you kind of realizing now that although music is music, some things have changed. And I just wonder whether or not in the these 10 years, how much thought you've given to diversity, not much in terms of your apprentices and your mentors, which we can talk about, but more in terms of your programming and the composers that you choose. Richard, is this, and Caitlin, is this something that, I mean, I figure with the pandemic, you probably had, we've all had a year to think about it, haven't we?
Absolutely, yes. And it has been something that's been on our minds since the beginning of the festival, but especially so in this last year. And the festival's actually formed a committee to work on exactly this topic within the last year. And there's representation on that committee from board, staff, mentors, and community members. And I think there's some exciting discussions and some exciting work. But Richard, I know, has made some programming decisions with this in mind. And well, I'll let you talk a little bit about.
Well, for upcoming seasons, we want to include music that will attract people whose backgrounds are diverse and may not have necessarily grown up with orchestral music. I remember as a child growing up in New York City, there was such a plethora of opportunities, many for free. I remember sitting on my father's shoulders at the Nomburg Bandshell or going to Carnegie Hall with my brother Philip, taken by my mom on the subway and when they still had wooden chairs. And not everyone has that opportunity. Mm-hmm. So to try to make it accessible, and one of the ways to make it accessible is to make sure that the people on stage performing and that the music you're hearing have a meaning beyond just the sounds and the notes, but it's that it's something that's being done by people like themselves. Yeah. So in upcoming seasons, we're doing much more music that is diverse, Asian, Hispanic, African-American. For many years, I worked collecting, after I discovered it existed, I found and edited and recorded for the Naxos label music by African-American Creoles de Couleur from New Orleans, composers from the mid-1800s, Edmond Dede, Samuel Sneye, families, dynasties of composers and performers of that era, who wrote really great music. And because of where they came from, they were relegated pretty much to a second-rate stance, except for Dede, who had the wisdom to go to France, and he founded the orchestra in Bordeaux in the 1860s. It's the orchestra that's still there now. So I think that there's a plethora, there's a dearth of music that is available. We just need to harvest it.
Right, a deep well, just gotta start lowering that bucket in there. But you have programmed, I mean, yours is not just, you know, the White Castle on the Hill canon music at the National Music Festival. You take a lot of risks, you know what I mean?
The program that the Aladdin Overture was on included music by the composer Dana Suisse, who dated Gershwin, the Cat Certo, which was by a pussycat.
That's right.
And Mahler's Fifth Symphony. So I do like to mix it up. And I think that's one of the tenets of our programming for the festival.
Okay. Well, you've given me a wonderful opportunity to do it, what we call in the business a segue, into Gustav Mahler. And we have, what we're listening to is a recording of the Symphony Number 3, Movement Number 5, What the Angels Tell Me. This is something that was recorded on June 13th, 2015. And I think in both listening to the Cole Porter and listening now, what I'd like people to remember is not only is this piece being played by professional musicians, the mentors, who are employed all over the country and the world as talented musicians, and their apprentices, which come from all over the world as well. So when you're listening to this recording, remember who's playing.
Thank you.
That was wonderful. Gustav Mahler's Symphony Number 3, Movement 5, What the Angels Tell Me, recorded June 13th, 2015. Man, we're all thirsty. I first of all, seeing all those people in the concert hall and all those people on stage, I mean, you know, I'll drink to that.
Yeah, that performance that we
did. And sorry, I got a joke. I'll drink to that. And one for Mahler. Please, you can edit that out. We can fix it in post. Go ahead.
That performance we just heard is a really memorable one for me because I sang in the chorus.
And oh, right. I thought I saw you.
It's such beautiful music to sing. I've sung in the chorus for all the choral works that we've done at NMF, and I love every one of them.
When she's not playing violin in the orchestra.
Right, exactly. Or excuse me, counting the, you know, pledges, selling the merch, you know, all of that.
Yeah, but that one particularly is just so lovely. It was a joy to sing. And I wanted to give a shout out to the Chester River Youth Choir, which was the children's chorus that we heard just now, and also to the women of the Chester River Chorale.
With whom you perform all the time. And it brings up another mission, hope, dream of the festival, which is the education outreach. Yes. That you do in town, the some of the classes that you hold, your Fiddlesticks program. I mean, tell us just, I mean, we don't have forever and I could listen forever, but tell us some of the outreach that you began 10 years ago and how it has grown.
Sure. Well, our primary educational program is our Fiddlesticks Youth Strings program, which of course with the pandemic, we haven't been able to do very much over this last year, but we look forward to getting back into the schools and being able to do in-person instruction again. We started Fiddlesticks in, I believe it was the fall of 2013, and we provide free string instrument instruction for local children in grades 3 through 8. And they learn to play Twinkle Twinkle Little Star on the violin. And then after that, if they like, they have the chance to either continue with violin or they can switch to viola or cello or double bass. And we've then also, again, before the pandemic, in the spring, we would always convene what we call the Fiddlesticks Orchestra, in which any students who are participating currently or have graduated from the Fiddlesticks program can come together to perform as an ensemble. And they would always do a concert at the National Music Festival during the summer. And that's been such a rewarding program for us. And we look forward to getting back to it after the pandemic and have a lot of dreams about expanding our educational programming as well. One thing that we've done during the festival for, gosh, I guess most of our seasons, I don't remember what year we started, is an instrument petting zoo.
Right.
Started as what we thought was a children's event where kids could try out different instruments. And it turns out that adults really like doing that too. And I think one of my favorite memories of the festival actually is probably must have been the first petting zoo that we did, and we realized that the adults wanted to try the instruments too, and that was great. And we had some stickers that we'd gotten for the kids, and the adults were like, can I get a sticker too? Yeah, it was just wonderful. So that was always such a fun event, and that's something that we're looking at doing, continuing to do during the festival, but also being able to do that in different places in the community during the year as well.
Yeah, that's great. Richard, I know you get, did you want to add to that no? All right, let me ask another question then. Before I ask you about the mentors, I want to ask about the apprentices. How do you decide is there an audition process? How do the apprentices get to be part of the National Music Festival?
I choose the conducting apprentices, and all the apprentices who come to the festival come on complete tuition, housing scholarships, mm-hmm. Most of their meals are taken care of, and we're actually working on a project that hopefully will be able to assist with their transportation as well. And I don't choose most of the apprentices, I choose the mentors, and they know better than I what they're looking for in an apprentice. They're looking for career track musicians with a great thirst for learning how to learn their craft and to be collaborative.
Take a sip of water, Richard. A sip of water.
Yeah, and I'll take over for a moment. So there is an audition process. It's all done by video, and prospective apprentices apply on our website at nationalmusic.us. We have different audition requirements for different instruments, depending on what the mentors for that instrument would like to see or hear, I suppose. so there's an application form, videos that they submit of playing particular pieces or orchestral excerpts or whatever it may be for that instrument. And then, as Richard mentioned, we make it very easy on ourselves for selecting the apprentices by letting the mentors do it.
Yeah. Richard, elaborate a little bit on the mentors. So that's a big orchestra. Do you have a mentor for every instrument?
We have at least one mentor for every instrument and multiples for the strings, because the string section needs to be so large. It would be a real burden for like a violin mentor to work with 32 apprentices. So we have usually about four or five of those. And they're chosen because they have a joy of music. They're really good at what they do. And they've also maintained a life. It's not just about music. I want people as mentors who I think can convey the needs of the career, but also the needs of surviving the career. And they are chosen from universities, from major symphony orchestras, and from all over the globe. We have mentors from South America, from Europe, from Asia, from...
Oh, everywhere. Baltimore.
Yes.
Baltimore. No, but there you have had a core, it seems as though you have had a core group of mentors from the beginning, at least people that I have met over the years, Tom Parchman.
Right.
I don't want to not include somebody, but I must say that one of the things I've loved about meeting the mentors is how much fun they are and how much fun they're willing to have. And I think that's important, don't you? Because we're not just talking about orchestral performances. There are chamber performances all throughout the festival in various venues. And that's a different animal from performing in an orchestra.
I don't think they come here because of what we're paying them. I think.
Oh, like public radio.
No. I think they come because of the repertoire, because of the other people that they get to work with. And I also give them, I invite them to give me their input as to what chamber music they want to workshop, what they want to woodshed, music that they hope to perform or record at some point, and to share that with their colleagues, both the mentors and the apprentices as well. And I think it makes a very healthy give and take. I think that many other organizations, they're told what they need to do. They begrudgingly do it. They take their paychecks and they go back and.
Yeah. Well, I think this calls for a little bit of music and orchestral, only because this is something that was actually recorded in 2016. So it's not that old. And again, what is it with you in film scores, Richard? This is
Miklos Rocha
from the film score The Thief of Baghdad, and this is The Silver Maid's Dance. But Richard, film scores, I mean, I know that that is a very deep well to lower a bucket into.
So many, I mean, much of the best American music is from the cinema. Mm-hmm. Before there was cinema, there was opera, and there's great music from that as well. But I just think that a lot of the film music is relegated to the back seat because we're watching the image on screen. Mm-hmm. But when you take it away from the film, that so much of it is the reason the films are so good. You look at The Heiress of the film with Olivia de Havilland, and if it wasn't for Aaron Copland's music, it wouldn't have been a great film.
Interesting.
Gone with the Wind would have just been another soap opera if it wasn't for Max Steiner. And Miklos Rocha wrote the music for El Cid, King of Kings, Ben-Hur. I mean, some of the greatest music of the 20th century. And one of his first films, For the West, he left Hungary and then wound up settling in the United States when World War II broke out. But this was kind of a propaganda film in which Conrad Veidt plays the most brilliant villain, Jafar. It's just every single note that Rocha wrote for this, I think really mirrors what's going on the screen and takes it another step further.
May I ask, given that during my career at NPR, one of the things that we realized when Oscar season came around in ways to cover it was to cover best film score nominees. And doing that, I learned about people like Hans Zimmer and everyone like that. Would you consider doing a contemporary film score in your program?
We've done music by John Williams, hope to do more. He has music that's being premiered this summer in Boston, in Tanglewood. Yes. And he just turned 90, but he's not slowing down at all.
Okay.
Well, everyone knows his music.
Yeah. Yes, they do. I'm not going to hum, but we're going to hear from the film score of The Thief of Baghdad. This is the National Music Festival Orchestra, recorded on June 10th, 2016. Thank you. Yikes. That was really very interesting. What a challenging piece of music that is. Yeah. And yeah. Yeah. And when I'm thinking, I mean, you have professional musicians in there playing, you have apprentices. When you're picking something to program, given the challenge of the piece we just heard, do you take the apprentices into account?
Yeah, on every program, certainly I want something that the audience members can walk out of the concert whistling. I want there to be something that I've always wanted to perform, but have never had the opportunity to do. And as artistic director, I can take some liberties with that. But it also needs to be music that the musicians can feel they've accomplished, and something that pushes them a little bit beyond their known boundaries, that pushes them to discover what else they have available in their small muscles.
Yeah, I mean, I think the challenge is what is important. I mean, because you can't walk away from a festival without having learned something. I mean, and I walked away from a festival learning a lot each time I've been there, but the apprentice, and everybody gets along. Do you also provide recreational activities for these kids? And I mean, do the mentors want to hang out with their apprentices for 2 weeks?
Actually, the first year of the festival here, I think the brass players drank one of the local bars dry after a concert.
Yeah, there is a lot of hanging out in local restaurants and bars after concerts. And other than that, we keep our musicians pretty busy most of the time that they're here. But we do give them a single day off in the middle of the festival. And our hospitality committee always puts together a fabulous picnic on that afternoon. So everyone has the chance to just be together and relax and eat really well, because we're musicians and therefore we like to eat
and drink. And I know the local businesses are very, very happy when the music festival comes to town, and in turn, they have been very generous to the festival when we all come to town. Well, it's a wonderful festival, and I have to say, this is the part where I admit why the heck I'm even doing this. When I retired from NPR, I got a call from someone named Richard Rosenberg. And he said he used to listen to me on the radio, and and he said, would you like to come up and to the National Music Festival in Chestertown and do Carnival of the Animals? I said are you kidding me? He goes, you've never done that before? I said, no one has ever asked me to do it before. And I had no idea what that was going to be like. So what I would like to do, let's play it first, and then we can talk about it, and we can say goodbye and say and celebrate and look forward to the next time we all can get together. This is Camille Saint-Saëns, Le Carnaval des Animaux, La Grande Fantaisie Zoologique, Ogden Nash, recorded June 11th, 2012, with your narrator. Okay.
At midnight in the museum hall, the fossils gathered for a ball. There were no drums or saxophones, but just the clatter of their bones, a rolling, rattling, carefree circus of mammoth pterodactyls and brontosauruses, of mammoth polkas and mazurkas, pterodactyls and brontosauruses, sang ghostly prehistoric choruses amid the mastodonic wassail. I caught the eye of one small fossil. Cheer up, sad world, he said and winked. It's kind of fun to be extinct.
Oh my God, I gotta say, of course, I loved it that you started out with me not knowing, with a look on my face that says, I don't know what I'm doing. I don't read music. And when I stumbled, and it's kind of like, fine, good on you, honey. You just kept going. And then when we finished that number, can I just say, I mean, I'm not used to having an orchestra behind me. And when all of the musicians, I never knew they did this. When the cellists start, when they start tapping their bows against the instruments, and it's how they applaud, I'm tearing up just thinking about it. And thank you for welcoming me into your family 10 years ago. And it's wonderful to hear that again. What are the plans for 2021? Are we talking about 2022?
Well, before I get into that, let me just say, you have no idea how excited Richard was when you agreed to do that.
Oh,
he was like dancing around the house, I swear. He was just thrilled.
You did it for many, many seasons. We even recorded the Prokofiev Peter and the Wolf, if I can ever get masters from the recording engineer. But we actually, I mean, we did it in recording sessions.
That's right.
And you did the narration after, but you did The Soldier's Tale and the tuba and the review, the cuisine, and so many wonderful things. And
it was so wonderful that you kept finding musical pieces that needed narration.
There's still a lot more, by the way. So.
Oh, hello. Yeah. There's you know where stuff. I live.
Absolutely. And I also want to mention before I forget that the excerpts that we've heard this evening and many, many other performances have been posted. Richard has been doing this throughout the pandemic on the festival's YouTube channel. So there's a lot of music there for everyone's listening pleasure. And I will follow up with an email to everyone who's registered for this session to share the direct link to that YouTube channel. So 2021, what times we live in. We are planning for a festival in August, not our usual June timeframe, but in August in 2021, and crossing our fingers, we hope that we're able to do it. The news recently has been a little less encouraging than we might like, particularly the rise in COVID cases among younger people, which is the demographic of our apprentices. So, you know, fingers crossed, but the safety of our musicians and our community is of paramount importance, and the board and we are, you know, considering everything very, very carefully.
Right. And rightly so. And I think the National Music Festival is so firmly established right now that the pandemic is not going to break it down. If Lincoln Center can come back, and Broadway can come back. And Lord knows, I did a show just this past January at Clear Space with all the protocols and an audience wearing a mask. And so I'm hopeful. I am hopeful that our 2021 is going to be better than our 2020. And maybe by 2022, we can, maybe by August, we'll know more. Richard, go ahead.
On the positive side, the pandemic has enabled us to become much better chefs.
Ah, excellent. Well, and goat herders, more goats and lots of goats. I've enjoyed the goats. The goats are great. And keep posting the music because we all miss it. All right. Caitlin Rosenberg, Richard Rosenberg, National Music Festival, 10-year anniversary. I will drink to that. Thank you very, very much.
Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Liane.